Welcome back to The Inspired Entrepreneur with Heather Hope. Hey everyone, welcome back. This is Heather Hope with The Inspired Entrepreneur. Happy, what day is it? Oh, you know, so after I record this, I'm going to go down to town. Oh God, that sounds so weird. And do my curbside pick up for groceries. And I am getting a calendar. I was looking on Amazon last night for a little mini calendar to put on my desk. My desk is getting pretty crowded, so I don't know. But so I can have a calendar because I keep clicking on my computer and that takes too long. And then I look at my phone and then I get distracted and I'm like, come on, there's no calendars in my office. So I will have a calendar because I don't know what day it is. Today in real life, in my real life right now, it is the 13th. So I believe I'm recording the 14th. So happy Thursday. Today is actually our 18-month anniversary, wedding anniversary, my husband and I, if you celebrate 18 months, which, you know, a year and a half, come on. So, yeah, I was thinking of stuff. So anyway, let's get started. My name is Heather Hope. Thank you for being here. Guys, I really appreciate the comments. I appreciate every so often somebody comes out of the woodwork, like a Facebook friend of mine, and tells me, you know, they've been listening to the podcast and really loving it. And every so often somebody will ask me a question or just tell me what's going on or tell me their manifestations that are really cool. So I appreciate that. I really do. Because now that I don't coach anymore, my life is really quiet, which I love. I love it. But every once in a blue moon, I actually like talking to people. So the introverts know what I'm talking about. But I do. I enjoy those moments. I don't like doing it all the time, at least right now, or being inundated or anything like that. But I do enjoy talking to people. And I really do enjoy meeting people like one at a time. I'm so describing what introverts are. But you know what I mean? Like I like getting to know somebody over a long period of time and, you know, chatting with them every few months, maybe. And I enjoy it. Like I just enjoy it. So anyway, feel free. If you ever like have this like feeling that you just want to like connect with me, feel free to. I think that's where I'm going. On Facebook, you can reach me more on Facebook, Heather Hope. You can reach me personally on my personal page through my name is Heather Hope Reed on Facebook, my personal profile. Last name Reed. I just changed it last month. I officially changed it with the MVD. I guess it's been 2 weeks. No. It was last week. R-E-E-D. So Heather Hope Reed. Anyway, because I would love to connect, especially those of you who are like daily listeners, feel free, you know, reach out when you feel called to and tell me where you're from. Because I know there's a bunch of you that are all over the place. And that has been typical. When I was really deep in my free group, I remember, I haven't looked in a long time, but I remember I had 100 countries represented in my group. So, and I had clients from all over the world and it was really cool. So I'm definitely not just for Americans. That's for sure. Because I am fascinated with other cultures. I'm fascinated with other countries. I would love to know where you're from, where you live, where you want to live. If you want to move to America, let me know. I can tell you all the reasons not to. I'm just kidding. I'm starting to appreciate America more lately, to embrace where I chose to be born. You know what I mean? Like we came in to this world. We decided everything before coming in. We decided who we wanted to be. Have our parents be, we decided the country, we decided all of this. So anyhow, I'd love to hear from you. Not everybody at once, but I doubt that would happen. So anyway, so yeah, let me jump into today. Today's a great one. Well, I mean, geez, they're all great, but not to say anything about myself. But so if you don't know, this is a daily podcast and based off of my book called The Inspired Entrepreneur. It's 366 days of inspiration for the entrepreneur, for the business owner. And even if you're not a business owner, because I know people who've been in my groups, in my programs, who are not business owners. And that's totally cool, because all of this, how you manifest one thing is how you manifest everything. It's all, you just change the words. And not every day we talk about business. Like most days we don't even talk about business, because it's not really about the business. It's really about how you feel in general, what your beliefs are, what your expectations are, all of that, just in general, and fill in the blank with whatever it is. If it's love, relationships, money, business, all of that. And once in a while, I do talk more specifically about business, but it really is fairly general. My book is fairly general. So let's jump in today, and I'll into today's message, and I'm going to tell you some stuff that I've been doing, I guess. So January 14th, today something really hit me to think much bigger. I wrote this, I don't know, a year ago, maybe longer, I don't know. So I wrote this. This was something I wrote a while back. Today, something really hit me to think much bigger. Looking at the big brains of our past and present, we are all capable of creating anything. If you're going to dream and visualize, go big. Abraham Hicks tells us to think big. Like, if you could have anything that you want, and you can, or sense you can have anything you want, you might as well. And I think that's coming up this week. I think there's a message. I've read the next few days. It's somewhere. Somewhere. I don't know where I read it. It's here somewhere. About what we're talking about going bigger, thinking bigger. Since you can have anything you want, since you can be anything you want, since you can, you might as well think that. You might as well go for that. The other flip of the coin is kind of don't put your net out there so far that you don't believe that you can reach it. So you have to work within the parameter of your belief system. So really it's about believing more, believing that you can. So some of the things I do, and this post or this day is all about that, like the big brains of our world. Listen to Elon Musk. Actually, he's really difficult to listen to for me because he stutters, and he's not a good public speaker at all. Like I don't like listening to him. But I do know, based on what he does, that he's a big brain in our world. Like, he is always looking at creating more, bigger, the biggest thing, things that we haven't done before. That's a big brain in this world. And he keeps his focus on where he's going, what he wants, and has, you know, Abraham says, enough, soft enough belief that it can happen. So believing it before it happens. So think much bigger. Okay, so for Christmas, one of the things I wanted for Christmas, or it was just Christmas time, and this is what I wanted, was I wanted Barack Obama's new book. And I forgot what it's called. It's on my nightstand. What's it called? I don't know. But it's his brand new book. About his entire, it's basically going through his entire political career. And I'm finding it very fascinating right now. And it's a huge book. It's 700 pages long. And I've been reading it for like a couple hours each night, and I'm thoroughly enjoying this. But you know, one of the things I noticed, like, he talks about him and Michelle and some of their friends and colleagues and all of that, like their circle of people around them. Now, they're both lawyers. They both, you know, have done big things, obviously, by now. But before he became president, you know, like, they were both lawyers doing stuff, both teaching, university being professors, all that like high level type of stuff. Like she reading her book, like I just ordered her book today that she wrote a couple years ago because I wanted to see her perspective as well. But she said that she was a vice president of a hospital. She's done a lot of high level things and he's done a lot of high level things. And listening to, or reading about him and their friends and what their friends do, very high level friends. And I'm like, wow, what a difference. And I thought about this yesterday and I'm like, the whole thing of like, you are basically, you know, the sum of the five people around you. Abraham pretty much agrees with that. You are who you are around. And like, who are you around? So I've gotten very picky over the years because I've always heard this. This is part of personal development of that you are the sum of the five people around you. And to, you know, choose people that, you know, you want to be like. So, and I, you know, I'm looking at my own life. Well, I don't know what I'm doing with friends, but like, and I used to have, like now, I'm an entrepreneur. I've been working for myself for several years now. But, you know, I think it's just easier when you work in a place or you have to network as an entrepreneur. An entrepreneurship is, can be a very different animal than having a job. Like I was a therapist and, you know, a lot of my friends were therapists or something like that. And it wasn't like very high level because I worked in an agency, but you know, we all had master's degrees and we're licensed and that sort of thing. So high enough level where, you know, there's a lot of school involved, at least a lot of education, which is great. But nothing like, you know, high level. Something. Personally, I never wanted to get into any kind of management or anything of a high level because I just saw it as being too much work and too much stress. So I never, ever wanted to do anything that was high level type of work because I just saw them as stressed out people and too much responsibility. I'm like, I don't want that much responsibility. I like to go home and be able to like chill and not deal with anything. So anyway, let's not get off too off base here. But, you know, it makes me think of where I want to go. Reading his book is giving me, because it's so influential. He's an influential person who, you know, who had the biggest job in the entire world. Like that's pretty big. And so reading his book is making me think bigger because I'm reading about somebody who has had the biggest job in the world. So anyway, his book is very fascinating and I love pulling from it of like watching his progression and watching it become basically the next logical step, of course, to be president, because it was just so everybody around him was like, you're going to run, right? You're going to run. And he's just like super undecided. Michelle was not on board. And it was one of those things where it was like he really could not run. Anyway, let's not go all deep into Barack. But anyway, think much bigger. So I took a nap yesterday. I've been taking like a 2-hour nap the last couple of days and I've been reading for 2 hours at night and feeling really good. I'm feeling really good. Just really spacing out what I'm doing, doing things that I enjoy, just feeling more positive about life. And so I took a nap last night, or you know, between 4 and 6 I take a nap. And I had this dream of what to do based off of something that he did that put him on the map. And so I'm taking some lessons from Barack of what he did or what occurred. He didn't do anything on purpose. It was just, you know, life gave him opportunities. The universe gave him opportunities that led him down the path of what he truly wanted. not necessarily to be president, but he wanted to make change. And he kept realizing that, you know, to make change, he had to be a senator. To make change, he had to do this. To make even the most fastest change would be to be president. So it was just kind of like he just was being led. We're always being led by our guidance and our thoughts. So I'm being led. We're all being led. But so I had this dream to do something. And it's been on my mind for the last couple of months. I've talked about it. And it was just clear in my mind of what I was going to do. So I have something special coming up on this podcast. I think it's going to be Monday. I'm going to do a video podcast. And I decided in my dream last night that I'm going to pick one day a week and I'm going to do a video podcast. And I decided to choose Monday. So I woke up from my nap yesterday and I come into my computer and I look, pull up my book on Google Docs and I look at what's the date for Monday. It's the 18th, January 18th. So I look up January 18th. If you have the book, you can read it. But I read it and I'm like, perfect. That's perfect. And so my husband comes in, I'm like, and I told him the story and I read January 18th to him. And he's just like, he just kind of like laughs because he's like, you just made that up. You just wrote that. I'm like, no, I wrote this a while back. I don't even know when, right? And he's just like, everything is always being lined up. Everything's being lined up. You just have to follow the subtle nuances, the subtleness of your thoughts, the subtleness of your dreams, the subtleness of your feelings, your guidance. It's just subtle. Most of the stuff that I get is subtle. It's just following what feels good, following what feels logical, or following what feels like the next thing to do. And it ends up being the right thing to do. And it's just incredible. And so reading his book, you know, which led me to, you know, in one of his book or in one of the sections, it talks about his speech at the DNC in 2004. He was asked to speak, do the keynote speech at John Kerry's thing, or for John Kerry at the DNC. And he was the only African-American senator at the time. He was just put in. And he put himself on the map that day with that speech. He wrote the speech. And so I went to YouTube while I was reading that chapter and listened to the 16-minute speech and went through the comment section. And people are like, who's here after reading chapter 3? And everybody, you know, this is a speech from 2004. And I realized what he did. In the first 6 minutes before he started talking about John Kerry, he talked about himself and where the heck he came from, because people didn't know who he was then. And here's this black man speaking so wonderfully. And it's like, who are you? That put him on the map, on the path to become president. When people heard that speech, a ton of people said he needs to run for president. My husband came in after I watched his speech, and I was talking to him about it, and he's like, yeah, I don't know if it was that one or another speech that I heard him say, and I knew he's going to be our president one day. It's one of those knowings. When you hear something or just know something, right, you just know. And it was way before Barack was wanting to do that, but other people knew it. It's annoying. So he's been led down that path that he basically could not do. So anyway, so I feel this within my own life of like, so I watched the speech and, you know, all of this is influencing me and what, and the stuff that I'm writing every morning, the 10 really cool manifestations of 2021. And so I'm watching things unfold. And I'm like, oh, that really goes well with what I've been writing in the morning. So when you focus on the things that you want, right? Go back to what day was it? I don't know. January 8th, 8th or 9th is I talk about the 10 things that I've been writing every morning. And I'm still doing it. And I'm writing it as if I'm just recalling what happened this year. Like, it's in December and I'm recalling these are the coolest things that happened this year. And I'm watching just things naturally unfold, like thoughts, ideas, things unfold. And I'm like, wow, that probably fits well with what I've been writing in the morning, or it does fit well. And I'm just letting it go. I'm not putting a whole lot of pressure on it. But anyway, so look for January 18th. I'm thinking about doing Mondays, doing a video podcast. So we shall see. Because I do believe that people can, when they see a person, they can, you know when you meet somebody in person, I have this thing, and it bothered me. This is another reason why I closed down my my group coaching program, online group coaching program. I have been wanting to do stuff in person for as long as I was going to the workshops, the Abraham workshops in person, and I was meeting some of my clients in these cities, and I loved it. I loved making these people real to me, making the people I worked with real. Because I mean, I worked as a therapist for years in an office where I could physically see them. I could see that, I could touch them. You know what I mean? And for me, I don't know about anybody else, but for me, I have this thing where I truly like love people so much more if I could be like in the same room with them. Like, this whole online thing really got to me. It like made everybody just an avatar, or made somebody just a name and a face and not a real person. And I was craving this like interaction of like, let me meet you in person because I will probably adore you. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know. I don't know. I don't ever hear anybody talk about this like this, but for me, it bothered me all this past year, 2020, and probably even more so because we weren't allowed to see people. You know, it's like even worse, right? So I had this craving. I talked to my husband about it all the time. I'm like, God, I just wish, because I could have this whole nice conversation with the cashier at the grocery store, because I miss that interaction. Being working from home, working from the internet, having clients in different countries, different part of my country, whatever. It just wasn't enough for me. I really craved that one-on-one in-person attention or interaction. Like, make this person as real as possible for me, and it will change everything for me. So anyway, so I know video can really help make somebody feel like they're a real person. Now, I love talking. I love podcasting. I love doing the recordings like this, but I personally know that if I do watch somebody's video, like actual video, at least once in a while, I get more from that. And I didn't want to believe that in the past, but I know how I am. So if I know I'm a certain way, I know some other people are a certain way, and I know that there's a whole belief out there that video is the best way to go. And I didn't, and I just know that whatever's best for you is the best way to go. But I also know that whatever's calling me, and I do want to do it, then that's good for me too. Especially, you know, because I'm progressing. So the whole thing with Obama, and then going to January 18th in my book, it was confirmation of, yes, do this. This is perfect. So anyway, okay, so if you're still with me, okay, let me get closer to my mic. I had to look out the window for a second. I don't know if I really want to do this, but I was in some deep thought today. I'm going to change the subject, and then I got to go because I got to go drive and get my stuff. So one of you, and I can think, one of you had wrote in my comment section last week about possibly talking about my experience as a therapist. And I had responded, yeah, I will think about that. And I thought about it, and I'm like, I don't know, because I don't think about it very often. And when you don't think about something very often, you just don't have much memory. But what I did get into some thought today, because it's my anniversary. It's 18 months, but you know what I mean. I was thinking about when I was watching 90 Day Fiancé. Jesus. I find it, like I said, I find it fascinating what people do. And how this one person, it's the 90 Day Fiancé the other way, where Americans are leaving America and going to the other person's country. And it's got like a different feel to it. But this one guy just basically being treated like crap, putting tons of like 40 grand into this girl. And this girl just does not seem to care about him at all. And he's noticing this. And I'm sitting here like cringing. I feel bad for the guy because I'm like, you're doing this. You have this vibration, this expectation of basically being treated like crap, not being cared about. Like you will care about her so much about everything. And she does not care about you at all. Like she didn't pick him up at the airport. He was moved to the airport or moved to the country at the airport. Right. Like normal people pick up their fiance at their, like, that's just normal decency, right? She wasn't there. And she's like, oh, sorry, I didn't make it to the airport. But you can take a bus. You're a big boy. She literally said that. You're a big boy. You can make it all the way over here. I'm like, holy hell, I'd be on the next plane out. Like, I would never be in that situation anyway. But, you know, it's like this guy, and he's feeling like total crap. And he's noticing more and more just how much she just does not give a crap. And I'm like, oh, this sucks. It sucks to be in that situation, but it sucks even more to not even know that you've created that situation with people. That makes sense. With what we know over here on this side of the world of law of attraction, we know that, you know, people show up the way that you expect them to show up. And when you expect people basically to treat you like crap, that's how they show up. Like that side of them shows up. Now, they may not be that way to other people, but they will for you. So I was sitting here. It reminded me of my ex-husband. Well, that didn't really remind me of that. A friend of mine shared a post about, she shared somebody else's post that was talking about how sweet her husband is, all the little things that he does. And it's not like these big things like candy and chocolates and flowers and dinners and all that, like romance from TV. It's all these other things that he does, like all of these things that are just amazing. And like my husband does a lot of things. But it reminded me somewhere of like my ex-husband was really sweet too. And so not to go too far in a tangent over here, but I was wondering about doing an episode of kind of what I know now, because I've said it for a while that I probably could save every relationship I've had in the past by what I know now with law of attraction, vibration, expectation, all of that. Because every relationship is savable. Shocking to hear that, right? Abraham, I learned something. It was in LA last year, the best weekend of ever, in going to an Abraham workshop. It was such a great weekend. But listening again, maybe it was in LA, it was Long Beach. I remember that. It was Long Beach. Listening to an Abraham I've listened to numerous times, hearing it differently, hearing that the whole thing of like, when you're in contrast and you desire something else, that you can get that something else from that current situation. Does that make sense at all? So if you're in a relationship that sucks for whatever reason and you want a better relationship, that you can actually get that better relationship within that sucky relationship. Now, I know I've talked about like, oh, just start over. It's easier. I do believe it's easier. If you've worked on yourself and you can attract something better, it's easier. But I'm not saying heartbreak is easy because that sucks. like breaking up with my ex-husband was one of the hardest things I ever did. But so I kind of reminded myself how bad it was, but how bad breaking up with people really feels. It sucks. It's terrible. And so when you get past all that pain, it seems to be easier just to attract somebody better or somebody better suited for you. But I was thinking about my ex-husband and I was thinking about all the really sweet, nice things that he did for me. And then I remember because, you know, like, so about the whole thing about labeling people like a narcissist or an alcoholic. So what we do as a society, and this is all from psychology, is we like to label people. We like to put them in a box. We like to tape that box up. Sorry for the dog. We like to put people in a box, tape it up, and slap a label on it, or mini labels. And that's just the way it is. And that person is stuck, trapped in that box with labels that they can't get out of because that is your expectation of them. And I sat here thinking about this, and I'm like, holy hell. I thought that was a really great visual of what we do and what I did as a therapist and what I have been trying to overcome as a former recovering therapist to not label people. I try not to, but it's been so ingrained in me that it's gotten better. But there's some labels that I still use just for simplicity sake when I talk to people. It's just easier to call somebody a narcissist, but because it's so well known. But thinking about the things that my ex-husband used to say to me that I just completely thought he was nuts. As the therapist, as the psychology person, what he was saying was nuts. But now, getting away from psychology and into vibration and law of attraction, what he said was spot on. Craziness, right? It's crazy to think. So I'm curious if anybody would be interested in hearing more about that. Because it's super insightful. It's like, holy crap, the things that we do and the things that he said. And the things that, like, because we just put these people in a box with the label, right? We put this label, which is an expectation. We have a list of expectations of how they're going to behave based on that label. So the whole thing, because I caught myself when I thought about the stuff that he used to do that was very sweet. That's what I loved about him. I loved his sweet side. He was insanely sweet. Well, we used to drive around. We'd drive, right? He drove a lot. And he would take my hand as we're driving, or, you know, he'd take my hand and he'd kiss the back of my hand. He would do that. He did that, you know, fairly often. That's very sweet. It's very romantic. It's super cute. Anyway, but he did a lot of things. He would buy me flowers. He would do a lot of things for me. A lot of things. So now my brain popped over to the whole, well, narcissists do that. They do that stuff to take you into their web and blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, literally, I had this conversation with myself today. I'm like, okay, so there's not this grand group of narcissists that this club that they go to, and there's this rule book of how to behave, and this is how to get you. That's not how it works. It's literally a few people that psychologists have found. They found some similarities, and then they slap all of these, you know, basically these behaviors of them that now become our expectations of how they're going to behave. And then they behave that way based off of our expectations. Craziness, right? Does that make sense? So I stopped myself thinking, Heather, he did not, this wasn't some grand plan of let me do all these sweet things. No, he was genuine. He was genuinely a sweet guy. And that's what I should have focused on. I should have focused so much more on the sweet things that he did and not focused because what you don't focus on will go away. It will go away. I continue to do it in my life. I continue to not focus on the things I don't want in my life anymore, and they go away. Now, some of the things I did with him was, and I should just end it here, but as, you know, labeling him as an alcoholic, right, before he went to the bar, because, you know, he would have, he didn't go every day or anything like that. But when he did go, like to a pool tournament or something, it was always the same ordeal with me. I was just expecting it to keep happening the same way that it always did. And he would get upset with me because he's like, why do you like already like say what's going to happen before it's going to happen? Then that totally like puts a whole cloud over all this. And like, it sounds like he was blaming me, which is what I, as a therapist, would say. But now I'm like, I see what he's saying. Like, I put the expectation there before he even left the house. I put the whole outcome of what's going to happen, how the whole night's going to unfold. I could tell you how the entire night's going to unfold every time. And it happened every time like that. What does that sound like? Pre-paving. It sounds like the expectation was very strong because I said the past behavior the past behavior of a person tells you what their future behavior is going to be, whatever, right? That's a psychology mindset. And it doesn't have to be that way. It doesn't have to be that way. We make all of this so crazy, right? So there's so many things that I now see and I'm like, but it's not easy to just flip a switch and be like, okay, I'm not going to think about that anymore. That's tough when that's been your experience over and over. So I'm not saying any of that is easy. I'm just saying that there's a lot of lessons I learned from that relationship that I could have changed so much. I could have changed it based on my expectations of him. I could have changed it because he said it so many times. He said the things that I say now. He dismissed psychology. He fought tooth and nail to go to counseling with me. He didn't believe in it. And I thought that was just crazy. Now I'm the opposite. And I think it's just not beneficial, you know, too much. Anyway, so there's a lot there. And I was curious if anybody would be interested in hearing a bit more of that. Because, wow, it's just all flipped. And that guy, he knew more. It's just an innate knowing of how things are. And I learned through psychology books and teachers and stuff, I learned a different way of thinking that is not necessarily accurate. So my ex-husband was right on a lot of things. And I thought he was crazy or stupid or uneducated or whatever. But no, he just knew. He knew what was right and what was crazy in psychology, and that in those moments were crazy. Labeling somebody, sticking them in a box, taping that box really shut tight, putting all the expectations of what that label represents, and then that person shows up like that. I can show up like any way that anybody can expect from me. Because do you ever like go around somebody and you just turn into a different person around them and you have no idea why? Well, this is why. Like, you might be like such a total bitchy person around one person for whatever reason. There's something about that person. It's that person's expectation of you. And that just pulls out that little bit of you that has that. Like, we're capable of being whatever, whoever, many, many different people, right? We're capable. We have all of these characteristics of ourselves. And we show up the way that person expects us to show up. So it's funny how our mood can change so quickly depending on who we're around, based on what they expect from us. And it's so subtle. And sometimes I wonder with my husband of like, if my mood changes, I'm like, I wonder if he's expecting me to have a certain have a certain, what's it called, mood or a certain reaction, right? If you expect somebody to react a certain way, they might react that way. Over time, they definitely react that way. So it's just crazy when I think about it. I'm like, wow, this is just, it's just basically everything we've been taught and learned, just flip it opposite. And then that's probably going to be true. It's such a mind blown thing. Okay, guys, I'm going to go. I have to go get my groceries. I have to inform my puppy dog that I'm leaving. I have to go. I have to check. Okay, good. I have to, he's going to be so upset. Well, see, that's my expectation, but okay. I got to stop that. See how that works? It's so insidious. It's like, it's just this ingrained thing that we do. It's like, oh, I know my dog's going to be super upset. Well, he's upset because I expect him to be upset. And then it gets worse and worse and worse. And I keep saying that, you know, it's just a self-fulfilling prophecy, right? Okay. I'm going to go. Have an amazing rest of your day, and I will talk to you again tomorrow. Bye, guys.